Hey guys, welcome back to another Blender 2.8 tutorial, and today I'm going to be showing you how to do 3D camera tracking inside of Blender without any add-ons necessary. Now, because 3D camera tracking is such a big and broad topic and there's a lot of techniques in 3D camera tracking, I'm going to take this tutorial and split it up into two parts. So in this first part, we're going to be dealing with footage that has tracking markers, which makes it much easier to track. And remember, our goal is to make a camera object inside Blender that matches the motion of the shot. So we want the camera to move in the same way and also have the same perspective. And by doing a bunch of point tracks on our footage, Blender can solve for our camera. So obviously in this shot, we're going to choose to track the markers on our sheet of paper. In a harder shot, we're going to need to get more creative with what we pick to track, but in this case, we just have it really easy. So the first step is converting this video into an image sequence. And this step isn't entirely necessary, but an image sequence doesn't have a frame rate, which ultimately gives us a lot more control. So when you can, it's always best to work with image sequences, but again, you don't have to if you don't want to. So all we have to do is go into the movie clip editor and then just import in our footage. And now that it's imported, you see on the right panel, which you can click End to toggle, you see a whole bunch of information like the resolution, the frame rate, and also the duration, which is in frames. And we want the settings in our Blender project to reflect these. For the video duration, there's two ways to do this. We can either change it manually here to 139, or we can click this button called Set Scene Frames, which does it for us automatically. And now these both have the same frame duration. Next, we need to match the frame rates, and to do this, go to the Output tab and then look for the frame rate options. Now in our case, we have a very weird frame rate, which is 29.87, and you see that's not an option here, so we're gonna have to use custom. And we can't just type in 29.87 because in this case, it's just gonna round up to 30. Instead, what we're going to do is scale both of these by 100, so we have 2,987 over 100. And you can think of this as division, which gives us our correct custom frame rate. And also, we have the correct resolution of 1080p by default. Now we just go into compositing and start setting up some nodes. So make sure that you have nodes and auto render enabled so you can see what you're doing. And we're going to take this render layers node and delete it with X because we don't need it for this. To bring in our footage, just click Shift A to add, and then go to Input, and then Movie Clip, and this gives us our node. And make sure that this is set to the correct footage that we imported before. And now all we have to do is hook these two up, and if we want to see what we're doing, we're just going to also add in a viewer node, and then just hook it up as well. Now that we're done with the setup, we're just going to go to the Output tab and then set this export to JPEG. And this isn't really the highest quality format, but it doesn't really matter for this tutorial. And then we're just going to create a new folder and set an output path. And while we're still in Eevee, we can just hit Ctrl F12 to render out our animation. Now that we've converted into an image sequence, we can start up a new Blender project. Again, we're going to go to the movie clip editor, but this time we're going to import in our image sequence. And to import in an image sequence, just select all your frames with A and then import them. And remember that an image sequence doesn't have a frame rate, so we can just go to the output tab and freely choose our frame rate. So I'm going to choose 30 frames per second. And for the project duration, we're just going to hit Set Scene Frames again, and that's going to automatically take care of it for us. Now notice that when we scrub through the timeline, the footage is a bit choppy. And to fix this, what you have to do is click Prefetch, which loads this whole sequence into memory. And now this is playing much more smoothly. Remember that we get our camera solved by just having a bunch of point tracks. For the Blender camera solver, we need to make sure that there's always at least 8 trackers visible during any frame in the shot. So the name of the game is getting as many high quality trackers as possible. We want trackers that last for a long time and have a very low average error. And to help us with this, we want to make sure that we're using the best settings for our trackers. The first thing we need to pick is a motion type, and there's a lot of options like location, for example, which tracks the location of a pattern between frames, but in this case it probably makes the most sense to use perspective, because our markers are kind of getting perspective warped as the camera is moving. We can also enable normalize, which is going to help Blender ignore some subtle lighting changes that might have thrown off our track otherwise. This does take some more time to compute, but generally it is worth it. Lastly, in the tracking settings extra, we're going to pick a correlation value of 0.9. This number is basically just a threshold that the tracker needs to meet during every frame so it doesn't stop. So when this value is 0, it's just going to ignore any error and just keep tracking. And instead, if this number is 1, it needs to be 100% confident during every frame that it it's correct, or otherwise it's immediately going to terminate. So 0.9 is a very high value, which demands a very high accuracy, but it does give us a little bit of wiggle room so it's not stopping constantly. And now we can begin adding in trackers with control click. And in the tracking panel, we get a zoomed-in window of our tracker, which lets us make fine adjustments and center it. We can also scale up this tracker with S, so our whole feature is inside the bounding box. Now, there's also a second hidden bounding box, which we can show with Alt-S, and this is called the search box. The search box just defines where we're going to search for our pattern between each frame. So a larger search box means it's going to search a larger area, but that's also more computationally expensive. For this shot, the camera isn't moving around very quickly, so we can keep this search box rather small. Once we're happy with everything, we can begin tracking manually by hitting Alt and then right arrow. This is how we track frame by frame, and you see that it's sticking on very well. To center this tracker to the view, you can just hit L, and that's going to lock it to the center. And after doing a few more frames manually, we can have it go through the rest of the footage by just hitting Control T, and it tracks all the way to the end. And of course, we can also check how good this tracker is throughout the shot. Once we're happy with this tracker, we can just lock it by hitting Control L, and this means that we're done with the tracker and we can't accidentally move it and mess with the keyframes or anything like that. So now we go back to the first frame with shift left arrow, and we have to do the rest of the trackers. Now this isn't going to take as long because we can do all of them at once. So I'm just going to pick a couple trackers. We don't need to do every single feature. Let's do something like 10. When you set up all your trackers, you can just select all of them with A, and then we're just going to hit Control T, and they're going to track all together. Then we can just hit Control L to lock all of them. And now it's finally time to work on our camera solve. So just go over to the solve panel, and you see a whole bunch of options here, so we're just going to take them one at a time. For the tripod option, we're going to keep this disabled because this shot has a free moving camera. It's not locked to a tripod, and it's not a nodal pan. Now for keyframe and keyframe A and B options, what this basically lets us do is when we do our camera solve, we pick some range that we deem to be very accurate, and then it's just going to extrapolate that. So keyframe A and B is basically defining this range. Now in this case, we don't really know what we should pick for keyframe A and keyframe B, so we're just going to let Blender decide by enabling this keyframe checkbox. And now we can click Solve Camera Motion, and Blender is going to solve for our camera. And we get some number, which is our solve error, which generally we want to make as small as possible. A solve error under 1 is somewhat okay, but if we can get it under 0.5, then that's pretty good. Basically, we want to get this value as close to 0 as possible, and as a result, our solve is going to become better and better. The first thing we can do to lower our solve error is go over to the refine options, and you see that we have a whole bunch of choices. We are going to choose the focal length and K1 and K2 option so that Blender tries to calculate what the focal length was in the shot, that's essentially how zoomed in we were, and also the lens distortion, which are these K1 and K2 numbers. And then we can just click solve camera motion again. Another trick for lowering our solve error is to go into Clip Display and then enable Info. And this is going to give us information about the error of each individual tracker that we had. Obviously, what we want to do is find the tracker with the highest error and then just delete it. We then click Solve Camera Motion again, and we should have a lower solve error. So let's say that we're happy with this now and we want to incorporate it into our 3D scene. All we have to do is click Setup Tracking Scene. And already this is looking very wrong, but that's because we just didn't set up our world orientation. The first thing we do is select 3 trackers on this table and set this to be our floor. We can also pick one of these trackers in particular and set this to be the world origin, so everything is going to be centered from this point. We can then pick any 2 trackers and choose a distance and then pick set scale so that the distance between these 2 points is defined to be however many units we put in. Lastly, to set up the X and Y axes, with respect to the origin, all we have to do is select a tracker to the left of the origin and then click Set X Axis, and then we pick a new tracker below the origin and click Set Y Axis. And now you see our camera solve is behaving how we expected. We can see our results by going into the rendered view and cycles. The plane becomes transparent because it's set to be a shadow catcher, however there are no shadows. To fix this, all we have to do is select our plane and bring it into the foreground collection. We can also go to the background layer that was set up when we did our camera solve, and we can delete it. And now you see that everything is working out as we expect. We're now going to go into compositing and set up our nodes before we render. And you see we already have this whole network that, again, is set up by default when you selected Setup Tracking Scene. I'm just going to delete this with X and show you how to make a custom node setup. We're going to click Shift-A to add, and then we need our movie clip for the background, and then our render layers for the foreground. And we can then overlay these two just using an alpha over node. And then finally, we're just going to add a composite node and also a viewer node so we can see what we're doing. And so far, you see that we have the background, but not our 3D objects. And that's because we didn't render anything yet. So I'm just going to go to the first frame and then hit F12 to render. And then you see that our render layers node updates, and then everything works out as it should. Finally, in the output tab, I'm going to set this to render as a JPEG sequence, which we can save in a new folder. And now all we have to do is hit Ctrl F12 to render out the animation. And that is the basics of 3D camera tracking in Blender 2.8. So in the next video, I'm going to be going over much more difficult footage, but also we're going to get much more in depth about how the 3D camera tracker works. So thank you guys for watching, and I'll see you guys in the next one.